Very good morning, all of you. Welcome to session 8. I am Dr. M.C. Nataraja, teaching the subject on design of steel structural elements 18CB61. My dear friends, in the last class, I was discussing about the importance of plastic hinge and what is the length of plastic hinge in a simply supported beam. In fact, I have derived the expression, the length of the plastic hinge in a simply supported beam subjected to concentrated load is x, and that is equal to L by 3. So this is what the derivation we discussed in the previous class. Now what is important is if you have a rectangular beam where the length of the beam is about L, say L is equal to 3 meter. So near the center where the load is acting for a length of 1 meter, so there is a plastic hinge being formed. So this is what the plastic hinge that undergoes continuous deformation leading to the collapse. Also see in a simply supported beam, so the two end points where the beam is supported, it acts like a hinge, and that is what is referred to as the mechanical hinges. So at the support, since it behaves like a mechanical hinge, so the beam actually rotates with respect to the end. Near the end, so there is no moment because it is a simply supported beam and there is only one vertical reaction. The beam undergoes rotation near the support without any moment. But on the other hand, if you see the central portion of the simply supported beam at the time of failure, a plastic hinge is going to form. And that plastic hinge will have a length equal to L by 3. And that L by 3 length will really undergo continuous rotation. And that rotation of the central portion, which is of L by 3 length, is very similar to the rotation of the end portion of the beam. End portion of the beam is rigid in nature, whereas the central portion of the beam is plastic in nature. So both the portions undergo rotation, but the plastic hinge will undergo rotation with a constant value of the moment equal to MP, which is the fully plastified moment capacity of the section. So that's all the difference. So that is the reason when the plastic hinge is going to form at the center, even though it has a length L by 3, for all practical purpose on the beam, it is shown as a point. So with that, and also with the two ends being the mechanical hinges, and one hinge being at the center, so the beam transforms itself into a mechanism and the beam is at the verge of undergoing failure. So this is what is referred to the formation of hinge or formation of sufficient number of hinges leading to the collapse of the structure by way of mechanism. Let us say what this particular mechanism is all about as far as the simply supported beam is concerned. In fact, it is the same beam. So this is what the bending moment diagram, and this is the mechanical hinge where you have the supports. So two mechanical hinges will be there here leading to the rotation of the end portion, and this particular portion having a length of L by 3 is represented as a block dot. So this and this being the mechanical hinges and this being the plastic hinge, so the member having a length L undergo failure into two parts. So this is one part of the beam called as the link, and this is another part being the second link, and the beam fails into two links. And this particular condition of the beam where it is just at the verge of undergoing failure is referred to as the mechanism. So in this particular case, it is the beam mechanism. The failure condition of the beam when it is at the verge of undergoing failure is the beam mechanism. So let us see what the actual definition of the mechanism is. When a system of loads is applied to an elastic body, it will deform and will show a resistance against deformation. That is what the property of the elastic body. Such a body is known as the structure. So obviously, any element which is resisting the load and undergoing deformation is referred to as a structure. By chance, if that structure fails to resist the load further, then it is at the verge of undergoing failure. So that condition of the structure where it is at the verge of undergoing failure is referred to as the mechanism. So that is the reason when a element is not able to offer any resistance against the deformation, then that particular element or the body is known as the mechanism. So there are different types of independent mechanism depending on the shape of the element. Now let us see how a beam undergoes failure depending on the type of the end conditions. So this is what the different types of beam mechanism, as far as simply supported beam, propped beam, propped cantilever and the fixed beam is concerned. So let us take the first beam, which is a simply supported beam. Obviously the simply supported beam is a determinate beam. So the degree of redundancy of the beam is zero, means it is determinate. There is no redundancy. Obviously R is equal to zero. So whenever you have a determinate beam where the redundancy is zero, so that element will undergo failure due to the formation of one plastic hinge as a mechanism. Now kindly see the mechanism, what I have shown here. So this is a simply supported beam, redundancy is zero, but you need to form one plastic hinge at the point where the load is acting. So with this one plastic hinge, so the structure fails. Then what is the conclusion? So for the failure or for the beam to transform itself into a mechanism, we need one plastic hinge, which is just one more than the degree of redundancy. So in this case, the degree of redundancy is equal to zero. Zero plus one means one plastic hinge. Now you please take the example of a propped cantilever. So in a propped cantilever, so kindly see there is a load. So this is simply supported. So this is fixed, but the load is not inclined. So obviously there is no horizontal reaction coming into picture. So we have two unknowns as far as this end is concerned. And of course this reaction being the third unknown. And in fact, we have the two equations of equilibrium available. So the horizontal equation is null and void. So obviously the redundancy of this particular element, propped cantilever. So this is equal to 2 minus of 3 minus of 2, where 3 unknowns and 2 equations of equilibrium. Obviously redundancy is equal to 1, R is equal to 1, and 1 more than R is 2. So that is where 2 plastic hinges should form in order to cause the failure of this cantilever element. So propped cantilever element. Kindly say this is the support where plastic hinge is not going to form. So this is the point under the load where plastic hinge is likely to form, and this is the support where other plastic hinge is going to form. So 1 plus 1 is 2. So 2 plastic hinges, and this being the mechanical hinge, so the structure undergo failure due to beam mechanism. So what is important is to know about the number of plastic hinges, and that is redundancy plus 1. Now if you see the third beam, which is the fixed beam subjected to vertical load, so obviously we have two unknowns here, one vertical and the moment here. So similarly another reaction vertical, but of course you also have the moment. So depending on the position of the load, so you can calculate the vertical reactions by taking the moment about the supports, and also you can calculate what is the total moment at this support and also at this support. So we need only two equations of equilibrium, but otherwise the unknowns are 2 to one side and 2 to the other side. So there are 4 unknowns. So minus of 2 equations of equilibrium, so obviously the redundancy is 2, and one more than that is 3. So that is what the number of plastic hinges, 2 plus 1, 3. So kindly see the locations where the plastic hinge is forming. So this is the point where you have the fixity, where moment gets concentrated. So the point where moment is likely to come, one plastic hinge is likely to form. So this is another end where moment is likely to occur, and we have one more plastic hinge. And obviously at the point where you have the point load, so we get one plastic hinge. So these are all the possible locations of plastic hinges, and obviously 3 hinges are required to transform this fixed beam into mechanism. So with all these three beams, with the loading conditions and with the support condition, so we can come to the conclusion like this. Number of plastic hinges needed to form a mechanism is equal to statical indeterminacy of the structure plus 1. So in a simply supported beam, so it is a redundancy is 0 because it is determinate. So just one hinge is sufficient. In a propped cantilever, two hinges. Obviously in a fixed beam, so three hinges need to form. Now let us see the other different types of independent mechanisms and how these independent mechanisms can be clubbed so as to get the combined mechanism. So the remaining independent mechanisms, which depends on the type of the structure. So we have a portal frame here. So the portal frame, due to the lateral load, it gets pushed, and as a result of this, it sways. And if you see the final position of the portal frame, so it is in the form of a sway. So this is referred to as sway mechanism or the panel mechanism. So as the panel, this portal frame, where two columns including the beam will be pushed, so that is the reason it is called as panel mechanism or the sway mechanism. Now if you see a gable frame, so this is one gable frame. Kindly see the original position of the gable frame in the form of a so dotted line I am showing. So this gets pushed laterally, where certain number of plastic hinges are going to form. So I have represented this like this. So here one plastic hinge, so this is the second plastic hinge, third plastic hinge, and the fourth plastic hinge. So this is a small error here. So this particular column should start from this particular point. So the final position will be like this. So kindly see how I will be showing by moving the cursor. So this is how the final mechanism looks like. So this is what is referred to as the gable mechanism. So whenever you have a multi-story building, where at a joint where you have more than two members, minimum three members should be there. So generally in a multi-story building, so any joint you take, in the periphery you have three members, and of course near the center we'll be having four members. So this is the original condition, where two columns from this particular joint, one to the top and one to the bottom, and of course to the left we have the B. So this particular joint with these three members undergo rotation in such a way that so all the three elements will be undergoing failure due to the formation of plastic hinges on the respective elements. So this is what is referred to as the joint mechanism. So panel mechanism, gable mechanism, and joint mechanism. So these are all the independent mechanisms of portal frame, multi-story building, or even the gable frame, depending on the situation. A joint mechanism generally occurs at the joint where more than two structural members meet. It can be three or it can be four, depending on the situation. Now let us see the concept of combined mechanism. So whenever we have a portal frame or a gable frame or a multi-story frame, so we need to consider the combinations of the different independent mechanisms. The various combinations of the independent mechanisms can be made depending upon whether the frame is made of a strong beam or a weak column combination, or a strong column and a weak beam combination. So depending on what is strong and what is weak, so you will be getting the combinations. So the combinations of the beam mechanism of a portal frame along with the sway mechanism is presented here. So two hinges at the base will form because the base of the frame is being fixed. So obviously we need to have two plastic hinges. And we also have seen the beam mechanism, so where three hinges are likely to form independently, but when you club it, we should be very, very careful to see that where exactly the cancellation of the hinge is likely to happen. So this particular hinge will undergo the same rotation as that of the sway mechanism. Here also, this hinge will also have the same rotation as that of the sway mechanism. But when you come here, the rotation of the beam at the center is exactly same as that of the beam mechanism of the portal frame. But when you come here, so there is a rotation of the beam element, and the rotation of the column element. So both the rotations are happening in such a way that the angle of rotation is positive. It is in one particular direction. So that is the reason the rotation of the beam element and the rotation of the column elements gets added up, and as a result, so a part of the beam element and the column at the junction will undergo more rotation. So in fact, the summation of the rotation of the beam, summation of the rotation of the column as a sway will be combined, and it gets added up here. But when you see here, so whatever the rotation of the beam element happens, if you take that as positive, the rotation, what happens to the column at this particular point, will be negative. So thereby, the two rotation gets cancelled out. But ultimately, the angle between the two member remains the same. So there is no change in rotation happens, and hence plastic hinge is not going to form. So there may be some moment at this particular point equal to or less than MP, or it can be still less than yield moment, or any value of the moment, or it can be even zero. But that particular portion of the frame is not going to undergo rotation. So plastic hinge should form only when there is MP, and that portion with MP, it has to undergo continuous rotation. If that rotation is not happening, there is no plastic hinge forming at that particular location. To appreciate why there is a cancellation of rotation and why the rotation at the other junction gets added up, so we can appreciate here. Now kindly see the beam mechanism of the portal frame. With respect to the vertical, so we have the beam here. So obviously one of the element bends downwards. Otherwise the angle between the vertical and the original position of the beam, that is 90 degrees. So when the beam is at the verge of undergoing failure, the angle between the beam when it is about to fail, again with respect to the vertical, if you see, that is less than 90 degrees. So obviously what theta you have here, it is such that the angle between the original and the vertical is going to decrease. Now here also the same thing is going to happen. But when you extend at this particular point, if you extend this particular element, so what the angle between the two elements will be summation of these two angles. The internal angle at the left and the internal angle at the right gets added up, as far as the central portion of the beam where the hinge is likely to form will have that combined rotation as the deformation. But what is important is what is happening at this particular point. So if you see the original position, the angle is 90, but now the angle is decreasing. Please remember that. Now when you go to this sway mechanism, so kindly see what is the angle at the bottom. The angle at the bottom is 90 degree with respect to the horizontal and with respect to the vertical, and now that angle is decreasing. But if you see the situation here, the original angle between the two members is 90 degree, but the horizontal part still remains horizontal, but the vertical column gets pushed away and it takes an inclined position. Now again determine the same internal angle which was 90 degree between the two original positions. The horizontal position remains same, but the vertical position is now inclined. As a result, the angle between the two members after the deformation is now more than 90 degree. By how much it is more than 90 degree? It is exactly same as this angle by which it will be pushed in the lateral direction. So kindly see this angle. If this is theta, so it is the same theta alternate angle, so we have that theta, and more than that theta is what is your original 90 degree. So this particular position of the frame where we have the junction of the beam and the column, so it undergoes a positive deformation of theta, which is the rotation, positive rotation. But at the same junction, as a part of the beam mechanism, it undergoes negative rotation, so minus theta. So minus theta of the beam mechanism and plus theta of the sway mechanism. So obviously when you add it, because the deformation is same, the rotation is same, the net rotation at this particular point of the combined mechanism, combination of the beam mechanism, combination of the sway mechanism, is something like this, where at this particular junction, so there is no deformation. So what happens to the column and the beam in the combined mechanism is something like a rigid body motion. So column, beam together will be pushed laterally, where the angle between the two members is not going to change. So this is what is known as rigid body movement of the beam and the column. And at this location, there is no plastic hinge as there is no rotation. And also the moment, if you calculate at this point after the analysis is over, it will always be less than MP, indicating that hinge is not going to form. And kindly see what happens at this particular location. The same concept you will be able to use. Now kindly see the original angle of the beam mechanism, 90 degree. Now after the deflection of the beam, the link and the vertical, the angle is less than 90 degree. Now kindly see here, with respect to the horizontal and vertical, the angle is 90 degree. Now what is happening here? Again, between the horizontal and the inclined, after the frame is pushed, so 90 degree is getting reduced. So less than 90 degree. But kindly see here, previously 90 degree, now it is less than 90 degree. So this negative theta and this negative theta gets added up, and we have the total rotation of 2 theta. Theta of the beam mechanism and the theta of the sway mechanism. So that is the reason. So this particular portion, we have the plastic hinge, but that plastic hinge undergoes continuous deformation in the form of a rotation, which is equal to the summation of the rotation of the beam and the sway at that particular point. And that is the reason for which at this particular point, so we mentioned that the angle of rotation is the rotation of the beam and also the rotation of the sway. Many a times we represent the hinge as far as the combined mechanism is concerned at this particular junction, similar to what I have represented in the sway mechanism. But kindly see the way I have represented the hinge here. I am showing the hinge at the junction, but not exactly at the junction. So very close to the beam I have shown. It means at the junction, the hinge is going to form, but that hinge forms in the beam position, in the beam part, because beam is weak compared to column. If column is weak compared to beam, so hinge comes at the junction only, but that will come in the column part. So it will come somewhere here in the column rather than here where you have the beam. So these are all some of the things we need to remember whenever you want to combine the two independent mechanism. When you combine the two independent mechanism, if there is no cancellation of a hinge happens, so there is no change in the internal work and the external work. If there is no change in the internal work and the external work, then whatever the value of the plastic moment or the ultimate load you are going to get, it remains same. So we need to look for such a combinations of the independent mechanism where the internal work associated with the combination should give rise to less internal energy. So that happens only with the cancellation of plastic hinges. Now let us introduce to one more concept. So this is what the concept of load factor. In fact, we have seen this load factor as a factor of safety applied onto the load. But in limit state method, as I mentioned, we have two factors of safety. One factor of safety applied onto the material partially, and one applied onto the load partially. Again, they are the partial safety factors. Safety factors, one for load, safety factor, one for strength of the material. Now here the load factor is just the safety factor for the load, where the working load is amplified so that we get a ultimate load. To get the ultimate load, we use this load factor. Now kindly see the definition of the load factor. The load factor is represented as F here, and sometimes in textbooks it is represented as lambda. So let us not worry about the notations, but what is important is the meaning of the parameter. So F is equal to W upon WW. So WW is the ultimate load, and that ultimate load is also many a times referred to as the plastic load, divided by the working load. factor of safety applied to collapse load is the load factor. For a simple beam, the variation of the bending moment with the load is linear. So this is what we have seen in the earlier discussion. F is W by WW, and W, the ultimate, as you know, it is directly proportional to MP, because the variation of the bending moment follows the load variation. W proportional to MP, WW proportional to the elastic moment. But WW, the maximum value of the load, what you can apply in an elastic condition where the stress is not exceeding the yield. So that WW is directly proportional to the yield moment. That is the maximum value of the elastic stress. WU by WW is equal to MP by MY, if you remove the proportionality. And that is again equal to FYZP upon FZE, because the plastic moment is equal to yield stress into plastic section modulus divided by the yield moment is equal to the yield stress. Actually, the elastic stress, the maximum value can be equal to yield stress. Otherwise, anything less than that is the working stress. The working stress simply F into the elastic section modulus. Now, if you separate Fy upon F for any value of the working moment, that is what the ratio Fy by F. But we also have the ratio Zp by Ze. So Zp by Ze, as you know, it is the ratio of plastic section modulus to the elastic section modulus, which is the shape factor. So what is Fy upon F? Fy is the maximum stress that is permitted in the elastic method, but the actual stress is much less than that. So the ratio of the yield stress to the elastic stress is what the factor of safety. So what maximum value of the elastic stress which is permitted, that can be allowed in a member, again that depends on the load to which the member is subjected to. So all these things we have discussed in the very first class, and some of the information related to factor of safety is also available in IS 800-2007 in the appendix. So factor of safety multiplied by the shape factor is known as the load factor, another way of representing the load factor. Now kindly see what happens to the factor of safety as far as an I section is concerned, and what is the shape factor of an I section is concerned, and when you multiply that, and what will be the probable value of the load factor for a beam consisting of I section. So that we will be seeing in the next slide, with this definition of load factor equal to factor of safety and shape factor. Now you know, for high section, the shape factor varies from 1.1 going up to say 1.5, depending on the configuration of the high section. The thickness of the web is very important in this case. If you take it as 1.12, the value of S for an high section, and the ratio of Fy upon F is equal to factor of safety as in elastic design, that is equal to Fy upon 0.66 of Fy. What is this 0.66 of Fy? So that is the allowable stress, or the permissible stress, or the safe stress in working stress method of design as far as the flexural member is concerned. And for direct tension, direct compression, we have a different value, that is 0.6 of Fy. But here in bending, it is 0.66 of Fy, that in compression bending. So if you take this 0.66 to the denominator, or 1 upon 0.66 is 1.515. So what is this 1.515? So 1.515 is the factor of safety as far as the working stress method of design is concerned in a beam design. Now the load factor with this factor of safety will be factor of safety of 1.515 into the shape factor for the I section, 1.12. If you multiply this, we are going to get 1.70. So this is what is being discussed in IS 800, in the earlier version of the code published in 1984 under plastic method of analysis. In actual practice, the load factor varies from 1.7 to 2. It again depends on what factor of safety you are considering, depending on whether it is a beam analysis or the analysis by tension member or a compression member. And also it depends on what is the type of the rolled section. So it may be an I section, but for a particular I section, it can be anything other than 1.12. But when you have an angle section, it will be different. And similarly for T section also, it varies. So shape factor is a variable, but otherwise the factor of safety may be more or less constant, and that in flexure it is 1.515, and with that the load factor will definitely be more than 1.7 and it can go up to 2. So this is how we will be able to find out the load factor. And if you want to know the load factor for the different combinations of the load, so we have to refer to IS 800 published in 1984. So that is the earlier version of the current code. When the structures are subjected to wind, the corresponding load factor for plastic design is reduced by 25%. So that is where 1.7 will be reduced to a lower value by 25%. With that, what happens to the actual value of the load factor? So that we will be able to see as 1.3. Load factor as per IS 800 1984 plastic analysis, and if you are analyzing for the dead load only, it is 1.7. All the dead loads need to be multiplied by 1.7 to get the ultimate load or the collapse load. And when you have the combination of the dead load and the imposed load, all dead load plus the imposed load both need to be multiplied by 1.7. But you are analyzing for the combination of dead load plus either the wind load or the seismic load, then both loads need to be multiplied with 1.7. But if you have the combination of dead load plus imposed load plus either of the wind load or the seismic load, both dead and imposed load with wind or with seismic, then it is 1.3. So this is how we will be considering the different combinations, and accordingly the ultimate loads are to be put on the structure or even the structural element, and it is to be analyzed for the collapse moment. Now if you really want to analyze a structural element, say a beam or a frame, so we need to satisfy certain conditions. So these are referred to as the fundamental conditions for plastic analysis. So there are three important fundamental conditions needed to be satisfied. So one is the mechanism condition, second one is the equilibrium condition, the third is the plastic moment condition. Generally, the equilibrium condition is satisfied. So that is what the mechanics of structure is all about. Algebraic summation of all the forces in the horizontal direction should be zero. And similarly, summation of the forces in the vertical direction should be zero. And similarly, algebraic summation of moments of all the forces acting on the structure or the structural element about any point on the beam or on the frame or on any other point also should be zero. So this is where sigma fx equal to zero, sigma fy equal to zero, sigma mxy equal to zero. So these are the three equations of equilibrium as far as the plastic analysis is concerned. What are the other two conditions need to be satisfied? The mechanism condition. It's a very important condition. What is this? The ultimate load or the collapse load is reached when a mechanism is formed. So this is what we have seen in the earlier slides in a beam. So it's beam mechanism. That when a simply supported beam, we have seen one plastic hinge is needed to form. The number of plastic hinges developed should be just sufficient to form a mechanism. So you have to have sufficient number of plastic hinges. So if the plastic hinges are less in number, in case of an indeterminate structure, collapse may not happen. But sometimes it can happen, but the type of mechanism may be different. But you need to have certain number of sufficient plastic hinges so that there is a mechanism, and that mechanism need to be analyzed by using the virtual work concept, which we'll be discussing later. We also need to satisfy one more condition, and that condition is referred to as the plastic moment condition. What is this plastic moment condition? So for the structure or the structural element, and if you draw the bending moment diagram, when the structure is undergoing collapse. Now for example, in a simply supported beam or in a fixed beam, at the time of collapse, so you have to draw the bending moment diagram. And if you see in the bending moment diagram, the bending moment at any section should not be more than MP. So kindly see the section where the moment is maximum, and that maximum moment should be at the most equal to MP, and you should not have any other locations where the moment is more than MP, but the moment can be less than MP and it can be zero also. The bending moment at any section of the structure should not be more than the fully plastic moment of the section. So these are the three important fundamental conditions needed to be satisfied while performing the plastic analysis. Now let us see the principle of virtual work. So this principle of virtual work plays an important role if you want to calculate the ultimate load. So in general, the principle is expressed in the form of an equilibrium equation, and that is external work is equal to internal work. What is this external work and what is this internal work? So that we will see taking some examples. The principle of virtual work may be stated as follows. If a system of forces in equilibrium is subjected to a vertical displacement, the load is moving through some distance. It is not the real distance. The load is real. The distance by which the load is getting displaced is virtual. So that is the reason the load is performing the work. Load into the distance is what the work. That's what we have studied in engineering mechanics. So since the displacement is virtual, we consider this as the virtual work. The work done by the external force is equal to the work done by the internal forces. What is this internal force? The internal force is nothing but the moment. So that is accumulated at the plastic hinge. So the plastic hinge undergoes rotation, but with a constant value of moment equal to MP. So MP undergoing the rotation is what the work, internal work. The external load undergoing the displacement, delta, is what the external work. So WE and WI are the external and internal work done respectively. This is simply a method to express an equilibrium condition. Therefore, if the work equation is formulated correctly, the equilibrium condition is automatically satisfied. It's quite obvious. So this principle can be used to determine the collapse load. Usually, it is not possible to satisfy all the three conditions of the plastic analysis in one operation. So this again depends on what type of structural element you are considering for the analysis and for what combinations. By chance, if you have a simply supported beam subjected to central concentrated load, then automatically all the conditions are satisfied, because there is no other mechanism possible. There is only one mechanism. There is only one possible bending moment diagram. And of course, equilibrium equation is automatically satisfied. But there are situations, especially in portal frames and gable frames and in multi-story frames, where it is not possible to satisfy all the fundamental equations. But satisfying the equilibrium equation is always possible. But out of the remaining two, mechanism condition and the bending moment condition. So we need to satisfy any one of the condition and analyze the problem for the ultimate load, and then check for the third condition to be satisfied. So this is where, we have two approaches for the analysis. A solution arrived at on the basis of assumed mechanism will yield a load carrying capacity that is either correct or too high. So please remember, the load what we are calculating based on different mechanisms, it is either correct load, or the loads what we are going to get is more than the correct load. So that is in the mechanism condition. So then what is the real load? There is one load which is correct. Otherwise, all other loads are higher loads. So out of the so many loads we calculate based on different mechanisms, we need to look for the smallest load. So that is where the correct load or the true load causing the failure comes into picture. Whereas the solution arrived at on the basis of a statical bending moment diagram, not violating the plastic moment condition. So we need to ensure that nowhere along the length of the beam or nowhere along the frame, so we have a location where the moment is more than MP. At the most, it is equal to MP. Otherwise, it should be less than MP. So if this is what the approach, then the load what you are going to get is either correct or it is too low. So we need to identify which is the correct load we are getting. The equilibrium condition, however, has to be satisfied in both the cases. So we will see the importance of the use of virtual work or even the use of Biddy Momand diagram. So when we go to the different types of problems. Now, as far as these fundamental conditions and how these conditions are used to analyze the structure, so we have three theorems connected with this plastic analysis. The first one is, as I mentioned, the lower bound theorem, and this lower bound theorem is also referred to as the static theorem. So please appreciate what the theorem is. For a given frame and for a given loading, if there exists any distribution of the bending moments throughout the frame which is both safe and statically admissible with a set of loads W, then the value of the load W must be less than or equal to the collapse load W. So the actual load, what you are going to calculate from the different combinations of the load as far as this particular theorem is concerned, which is based on the bending moment diagram, it is always be less than or at the most it is equal to the ultimate load. So the different loads what you get, so we need to identify the maximum load, which is actually the collapse load. The load computed on the basis of the assumed equilibrium moment diagram in which the moments are not greater than MP is less than or at the best equal to the true ultimate load. So this is what the meaning of static theorem or the lower bound theorem. So this is based on the bending moment diagram. The second theorem is based on another concept. It is called as the kinematic theorem or the upper bound. So upper bound theorem. You are forming a bound, the upper bound to the load, where the load is not exceeding that value. Means the load is always be less than the maximum value. For a given frame subjected to a set of loads W, the value of load what you are getting, which is found to correspond to any assumed mechanism. So there could be 2, 3, 4, 5 combinations of mechanism. In each of the mechanisms, we have to calculate the load. The value of the load what you get from each of the mechanisms is either greater than or equal to the collapse load. If the collapse load is W, the load what you are going to get from the different mechanisms is always be greater than W. A load computed on the basis of the assumed mechanism will always be greater than or at the best equal to the true ultimate load. So I will be again explaining this upper bound and lower bound theorem. So when I take a continuous beam problem where it will be analyzed not only by the upper bound concept and also by the lower bound concept. And in many situations, the use of kinematic approach based on the mechanism approach is assumed to be simple, and which I will be explaining in the continuous beam. And there is one more theorem called as the uniqueness theorem. The load what you are going to get is unique. So we are getting only one load, so which is actually the true load, where all the three conditions are automatically satisfied. For a given frame and loading, if at least one safe and statically admissible bending moment distribution can be found, and if this distribution, the bending moment is equal to the fully plastic moment at sufficient cross sections to cause failure of the frame as a mechanism due to the rotation of the plastic hinges, then the corresponding load will be equal to the collapse load. So obviously we need to look for a statically admissible bending moment diagram. So this is what the bending moment diagram, where the moment is not greater than MP, and only at that particular location where the hinge is likely to form, only at that location the moment is MP, but in all other location the bending moment is less than MP. So if this is the situation where all the three conditions are automatically satisfied, the load what you are going to get is the true collapse load. All the three conditions, that is equilibrium condition, continuity condition and yield condition are satisfied. So students are hereby informed to remember these theorems and try to give some explanation also as far as the importance of the theorems are concerned. And how we will be able to analyze a beam or a frame using this plastic analysis and how to satisfy these conditions. So we have two approaches. So one approach is called as the static approach. In static approach, so you'll be using the minimum and diagram, and finally we'll be checking for the formation of the mechanism with that ultimate load. Whereas in case of kinematic method, so we'll be assuming the mechanism and the ultimate load is found, and with that ultimate load later if you draw the bending moment diagram, so we need to ensure the condition of the moment nowhere along the length of the beam or the frame the bending moment is more than NP. So two conditions are satisfied in the static method: equilibrium method and the bending moment diagram. And in the kinematic method, we are satisfying the equilibrium condition and the mechanism condition. For complicated frames, the static method of analysis is more difficult, and finding the correct equilibrium equation becomes misleading. So that is the reason in such cases of complicated structures, kinematic method plays an important role and is really practical. And how we will be able to solve the problem using this static approach? This consists of selecting the redundant forces. You have a beam subjected to different types of load, and of course different end conditions also comes into picture. So we need to identify the redundant forces depending on the degree of redundancy. We need to draw the free bending moment diagram and also the bending moment diagram for the redundant forces. And we have two bending moment diagrams, the free bending moment diagram being the positive bending moment diagram and the bending moment diagram for the redundant. So we call it as the redundant bending moment diagram or the fixed bending moment diagram. So both the diagrams need to be superposed, and the net bending moment diagram need to be identified. And that is the combined bending moment diagram, which is to be used, analyzed, and later we need to ensure that the mechanism is going to form with that diagram. Collapse load is found by working out the equilibrium equation, and that equilibrium equation all the time we need to follow. It is checked that the bending moment is 2 more than the fully plastic moment at any section. Now what is this kinematic method? So this consists of locating the possible places of plastic hinges. So what are the possible places of plastic hinges? If you have a beam where you have a concentrated load, so at that point where the load is acting, plastic hinge is likely to form. If you have a series of concentrated loads, at all these locations, plastic hinges are likely to come. So individually and independently, we need to analyze the mechanisms, and also for all positions of the loads, we need to identify the mechanism. And at the fixed locations, the fixed end where the moment is likely to come, so there also the plastic hinge is likely to come. Now if you have a beam which is non-prismatic, the span is L, but for off span the moment of inertia is higher or lower, and where there is a sudden change in the cross-sectional dimension of the element, and at that location where the change in size and shape of the structure happens, and that is also one possible location where the plastic hinges can form. So with this condition of likely locations of the plastic hinges, we need to identify the number of plastic hinges. Possible independent and combined mechanisms are then ascertained. So the combined mechanisms also comes into picture in case of beam mechanisms with series of loads. Otherwise, as I mentioned, in case of portal frame, so we have the sway mechanism and the beam mechanism both put together, we have the combined mechanism. But in case of multi-story frames, two bay frame or two story, three story, so we need to look for the joint mechanism also being the independent, and that need to be added to the other independent mechanisms. The collapse load is found by applying the principle of virtual work. So principle of virtual work, where the external work is equal to the internal work, comes into picture in a kinematic method. A bending moment diagram corresponding to the collapse mechanism is drawn after the analysis is over, and it is to be checked that the bending moment is not more than the fully plastic moment at any section. So this is where the violation of the condition where bending moment at any section along the length of the beam or the frame exceeding MP is not going to happen. Now let us see what this rigid plastic analysis. Now this is what the beam we have considered in the earlier discussions also. So it is a simply supported beam having a span L. So that's what we'll be able to make out. And one plastic hinge will form, and this is the location of the plastic hinge at the center. And of course this has got a length, but in this case it is L by 3, and it is a stiff portion of the beam. So before the failure, the entire beam was stiff. Once the plastic hinge forms, so except that location, so we have the two other portions. So the other two portions are really stiff and works as a rigid element. And that is what the two elements undergo rotation continuously, leading to the failure. And that condition is what is referred to as the mechanism. And that is what the mechanism I have shown here. Now this beam having a span of L is assumed to break into two links. So even though the plastic hinge has certain length, for all practical purpose, this entire hinge is being assumed as a point, as you can see here. So one portion of the beam to the left, if it is at the center, the load is acting. So that is one segment of the one link of L by 2. This is another link of L by 2. And both the links at this particular point gets displaced vertically by an amount called delta. So delta is the displacement where the load is undergoing that displacement, leading to the formation of a mechanism and then to the final failure. And if you see, the link to the left undergoes a rotation of theta. Similarly, the another link also undergoes a rotation of theta. And obviously the portion of the beam that was horizontal, with respect to that horizontal, so the final displacement of this particular portion of the beam, now considered as a point, will undergo total rotation. And that total rotation is theta to the left and theta to the right of the two links. And that is what the combined rotation 2 theta. Here the beam is symmetric, load is acting at the center, and the hinge undergoes a rotation of 2 theta. Otherwise, the left link undergoes theta rotation, the right link again undergoes theta location, theta rotation, and with this theta, if you see at this point, so the portion with respect to horizontal will undergo a displacement of 2 theta. And also this bending moment diagram, the MP corresponding to the center and MY corresponding to this particular section where the extreme fiber has just yielded, and many of these things we have seen in the previous class. And also the linear variation of moment of rotation and the non-linear behavior, so because of the shear factor effect, and then the continuous plastic deformation. So all these things we have seen in the previous classes. Now if you apply the work equation as far as this particular problem is concerned, so I have not shown the load W here, so the load is here, so W. The W pushes the beam by an amount delta, so that delta being the displacement. What is this displacement? This is a very small virtual displacement. So since the displacement is very small, and if you take this particular diagram to be triangular in nature, so this depth can be determined. Or if you take this as an arc, so the arc of a circle, where this is a very small arc, the displacement being the arc, so you know that this arc is nothing but the radius and the angle subtended by the arc. So this length of the length of the beam, L by 2 into theta, so that is what is nothing but this vertical displacement delta. So load multiplied by the vertical displacement, load into delta, where delta is L by 2 theta. So that is what I have mentioned here. So kindly see, the work done by the displacement of the load, W into delta, delta is L by 2 theta. that should be equal to the internal work. What is that internal work? The internal work will be done by the moment. External work done by will be done by the load. So this internal work done by the moment due to what type of deformation? Rotational deformation. But the load is undergoing the displacement. Load into displacement and moment into rotation. So this is what the total work or the energy. So MP, the internal load, that is the moment, multiplied by 2 theta. And this MP into 2 theta being internal should be equated to W into L by 2 theta being external. So with this we can calculate either MP or the value of W. What is this W? This is the load at the verge of failure. Obviously this load W will be represented as W. So with this MP is equal to WL by 4, where W is the ultimate load corresponding to plastic moment, or the plastic load is equal to, the ultimate load is equal to 4 MP by L. Now if you have a given ultimate load over a span of L simply supported, if you really want to do the design, what is the type of the I section to be selected? So you have the steel table where all the properties of the I sections will be listed, and we also have discussed the different I sections that are available: Indian standard lightweight beam, Indian standard medium beam, so heavy beam. So many such beams we have discussed in the previous classes. And with this ultimate load, calculate the MP. And we know that the MP is equal to Fy into plastic section modulus. So if you select Fy as 250 and the corresponding steel, so what is the plastic section modulus that is needed for that MP so that the beam with that section can be selected? So in order to ascertain that, so we need the plastic section modulus. So from the plastic section modulus, so we can really do the design so that that beam will provide you that resistance MP when you want to design it for that ultimate load. If you have already have a beam with certain plastic section modulus, say the beam is ISMB 300 kept over a span of 4 meter or 5 meter as a simply supported beam. So what is the load that really causes the failure if it is used as a simply supported beam with a central concentrated load? So anyway, you have the beam. For that particular beam, so we will be able to calculate what is the plastic section modulus, again by referring to the steel table, and also see what is the yield stress of that particular steel and any yield stress. And with that, if you have the section purchased from the market, so we will be able to calculate the MP. Over the span L, maybe 3 meter or 4 meter as a simply supported beam, what is the ultimate load the beam can carry? So that can be determined. So with that ultimate load, if you apply that ultimate load onto the beam, your beam is really going to fail. But the beam should not fail. It has to resist the load for the life of the structure for which you are doing the design. Maybe 25 years or 40 years or 50 years. So obviously, we need to apply only the working load. So W is the ultimate load, divide that by load factor and get the ultimate load, get the working load. And with that working load, so we can use the beam for the design period, which may be 25 years or 40 years or 50 years as I mentioned. So this is from the point of identifying a section for a given load or a given ultimate load. And if you have a beam kept over certain span, what will be the maximum load that causes the failure, and eventually what is the working load that can be applied? So this is how the work equation is being used, and the different types of beam can be analyzed. So friends, in the next class, so I'll be discussing about the different problems in connection with shape factor, in connection with determination of plastic section modulus for different regular sections and rolled sections, and also the analysis of simple beams and continuous beams as well. So with this, I will stop my presentation, and thank you very much. If you have any questions, you can ask. Thank you very much. We'll stop at this stage.